There are between 5,000 and 6,000 autistic children in Britain. The condition is as common as total deafness, more common than total blindness. The name autism comes from the Greek word autos, meaning self. A child who is autistic is self-absorbed, withdrawn, remote from the world around him. He can't communicate. No one knows what causes autism. No one can cure it. It's a lifelong handicap, and the life expectancy of an autistic child is perfectly normal. He may live 60, 70, 80 years. That is the basic, crucial fact about tonight's Panorama report. In the 25 years since psychiatrists first identified autism as a condition separate from other kinds of subnormality, virtually no special provision has been made for the adult lives of autistic children. And that has now become desperately urgent, because it's now that the first generation of diagnosed autistic children are reaching adulthood. We can only guess at how many undiagnosed cases are already grown up and lost to all hope of special treatment. We start by looking at how well we are preparing today's autistic children for the much longer and harder adult life that is to follow.
Many children who are retarded in development but who are not autistic are able to understand, at least up to the level at which they've developed, are able to understand what life is about, perhaps in a rather simple way, but they can interact with other people. They can learn from interaction with other children in groups. They can learn by playing. They're slow, but they can benefit from these very normal activities. The autistic child is at a great disadvantage because he doesn't pick up things from his environment. He doesn't interact with other children. He doesn't play imaginatively because he hasn't got the inner language which enables him to understand through his play and through his interaction with other children.
Have we any idea as to how an autistic child sees the world?
It's very difficult to imagine anyone who's got normal language and the ability to think, but I do know one young man who was certainly autistic as a child. He's made very good progress. He's still nowhere near normal. When he was asked what it was like as a child, he said that he remembers that nothing that ever happened could ever be explained. He never understood why things occurred. Every event seemed to come out of the blue, unconnected with any other event. He had no way of predicting what was going to happen in the future or explaining what had happened in the past. It was like as if perhaps one was placed on a very strange planet run by totally different laws from this world. And he remembered being in a constant state of fear, not knowing what to expect. For the autistic child to learn, especially when he's young, somebody, an adult, has got to plan every step. He doesn't pick it up from the air. It has to be planned for him.
The responsibility of planning an autistic child's education rests with local education authorities and with men like John Hill, County Education Officer for Suffolk. Local authorities do provide some facilities themselves and pay the fees at private special schools. But the record throughout the country is patchy. The problem is not simply resources, but also diagnosis.
The sheer testing of an autistic child is difficult, because normally you work through the eyes and ears of the child, and if the child is autistic and doesn't want to see you or to know you, then it's very difficult to arrange tests which can tell you in any convincing way what the prognosis is.
But in your experience, it's something which has to be done early.
It's got to be done early, and the earlier the better. Of course, we're dealing with a classification of children which is fairly recent. We wouldn't have known about autistic children sort of 7, 8, 10 years ago very much. We have tended to think that there is a strong link between them and education of subnormal children, and we have provided for the few, and there aren't many, of course, in a county of this size, which is just under 600,000, in schools for the subnormal, in classes for the subnormal, sometimes in ordinary schools, sometimes in special schools, sometimes in special units, and sometimes beyond the school system in psychiatric units attached to hospitals.
How do you decide which form of education or environment is the right one?
Well, we take what advice there is. And I think probably it's true to say that we need better advice and more concentrated advice than we've had before, with the development, which we all hope for soon, of more assessment units to work on small children, so that we can know what is possible and what all our troubles and difficulties are likely to be, and how we can then harness the teaching profession to cope with them.
So, looking at the forms of treatment which you provide for autistic children, what is common to them all?
I think a one-to-one relationship very probably would work, and that has to be an effective and warm relationship, and with as much technical skill as we can put into that teacher to help.
And how difficult is that to achieve?
I think it's very difficult indeed. It's miraculous sometimes to see what teachers do with some children.
Take two, yellow. Good, that's smashing. Rebecca, you looking? You take two long blue rods. Take two long blue rods.
There is hope for autistic children. At the other extreme from crowded hospital wards, there are the special schools and units, some run by local authorities, some, like this one, by the National Society for Autistic Children. The aim is not to cure the condition, that can't be done, but to make the most of the limited ability of each individual child.
Up here, one cup of tea. How much does it cost?
Six.
Six. Two cups of tea cost.
Ten.
Two, Terry. Look, two sixes are...
12.
12 pence, yes. How much will two bottles of lemonade cost?
There are many degrees of autism. The mildest cases can sometimes make progress at an ordinary school. The most severe would be too disruptive even for a special one. The 30 children who attend here are drawn from the majority that come somewhere between those two extremes.
What's he called?
Mark.
What's your name?
Michael.
Do you often play together?
Yes.
What do you like playing?
I sit and talk to him.
Some, like Michael, can hold a conversation. Some cannot. Getting through to Julia's private world is particularly difficult. She's deaf as well. Her obsession with the gerbil is all-absorbing, and she's allowed to indulge it for a limited time each day. Up to this point, she had been fascinated by our camera, but when the gerbil was produced, she was aware of nothing else.
Do you like the doll, Rebecca?
Yeah.
What colour trousers have you got?
Green.
Green trousers, yeah.
This doll has got trousers.
What about this one? Let's put the two dolls together. But is it a big doll?
The teaching method at the school is based as much as possible on a one-to-one relationship, close and intense, between teacher and child. The children must learn how to learn, the first step on what is for them a very difficult road, but which may enable some of them in time to cope with living and working in a less protected world.
Which is the biggest square?
That one.
What's this shape called?
Triangle.
This one?
Triangle.
Two triangles. Which one is the biggest?
That one. Ma.
That's the biggest, yeah. Which triangle is the smallest?
That one. Ma.
Can you give me the big one? Let me have the big triangle. That's good. Let's put them together, shall we? How many squares have we got?
One, two.
Two, and how many triangles have we got?
One, two.
Can you give me the biggest square? Can I have the biggest square? That's great. Okay. Can I have the smallest triangle? Can you look? Look at the table. What's this one?
The square.
Yeah. Is it a big square?
No, it's a small square.
Small square.
We do not sit around saying, poor little thing, how dreadful. Let him go on being like that because poor thing, he can't help it. We in effect say to them, you're a human being, and to be human is to get up on your feet and do what you can. And we can be extremely cruel in order we hope to be kind.
In general, how do you measure success? in what you're doing? And what degree of it do you think you've achieved at the school?
I think some of the children have made tremendous strides on anybody's terms. We've certainly taken children who came to us when they were young, doubly incontinent, not feeding properly, not talking, with no skills, with very antisocial or asocial behavior. We've made their behavior more normal. We've taught them to feed themselves, to be clean. We've taught them to speak. We've taught them to read and to write and to acquire all kinds of skills. And of course, with that, they become much better integrated and they're much happier. We have children who have not achieved as much progress as that, but who are doing better in this sort of setting and who are functioning in a more nearly normal way than they would be able to in any comparable setting. I think one has to look not only at what they have achieved, but what the regression might be if they were in a less sympathetic environment.
How quickly do they regress when taken out of an environment such as this?
It can be very dramatic. It can be a matter of weeks.
And it would be as though they had never learnt what they had learnt.
Yes, I think so.
Do you think you achieve any permanent improvement in their basic condition, or do you simply modify the symptoms while they're here in this environment?
I think one does two things for almost anybody who is handicapped. You modify the environment to suit them, and you also make them do what they can.
A.
B.
Hmm. Then what?
C.
Mm-hmm. What a child can do may even take the staff by surprise, as when Robert, some months ago, suddenly showed a talent for music.
G sharp. No. A sharp.
Yes. Are you going to play something for us?
How many times does Robert have to hear a piece of music before he's able to play it?
As far as I can tell, it would be one or at most two hearings. He started to tell me in the mornings what he's heard
eight,
the previous
ten.
Day, the previous weekend. And I say, what have you played at home, what have you heard? And he tells me, and then he plays it.
And how long has it taken him to reach this stage?
Well, I started with him 3 or 4 months ago. And he's been able to play like this for 2 months. I've been doing this with him every day for about the last 2 months, hearing the symphonies and the concertos. You play the Grand March, I see.
The school was set up 6 years ago by the National Society for Autistic Children, an organization founded by parents in the early 60s. It's schools like this which have done much of the pioneer work in finding ways of getting through to the world of autism. It costs £1,200 a year to keep a day pupil here, £1,550 for a boarder. Although the fees are paid by local education authorities, the going has still been tough.
We started in September 1968 with one old house, very little money, and 5 children. We now have 3 old houses, 30 children, and very little money.
Where does the very little money come from?
Well, the running costs, in theory, are met by local education authorities who refer children to us. We don't take any private fee-paying children. They all come to us via the local education authority who pays the fees, which are very high. We're rather fond of calling this place this other Eton. But even so, the high fees only actually meet running costs, which means that we do not make any sort of profit or surplus. If we have a large capital cost, like another building, or the roof falls in, or we want something extra big in the way of playground equipment, we really have to go out and raise funds ourselves. And in fact, staff are very involved in this. The young man that you saw teaching music to little Robert got a walk sponsored from Gravesend to Rye, which is all of 50 miles. And quite a few of them went the whole way, with him at their head, I may say.
An outing to the zoo is not simply entertainment. For autistic children, it's also a vital part of social education, learning to adjust and to behave acceptably in a wider world. But this kind of specially geared program, whether from the National Society or local authorities, is at present only available to 1 in 5 of the country's autistic children. For this family, more than most, the special school has been a godsend. Michael, the son, is autistic. So is the daughter, Kathy. Both children, in their mother's view, have been making progress.
They are so much easier to live with. And the fact that they are enjoying a life, you know, I think that's very important. I think at the moment Michael is having a whale of a time, really, you know, and I think he's really enjoying his life. Now, I couldn't see that 5 years ago.
No, because
to me, he was a miserable little child, you know, he wasn't... There didn't seem, in his mind, there didn't seem to be an awful lot of good in the world, you know.
Yes.
There's nothing to be very happy about.
But the school can only take 1 in 5 of those who apply for places. What happens to the others?
I don't know. It's a bit like the lifeboat syndrome. You look after the ones you've got in the boat. If you start worrying about all the ones in the water, you're likely to go down.
But how long will it be before we're able to provide all of the country's autistic children with the special facilities they need?
Well, it'll be a matter of resources. it isn't. There's no magic key to these problems of handicapped children at all. We try to do our best, and our best is with some children very good. Our best with some other children is not very good, even though we try. But we need more help on the medical side and on the assessment side, and we need to be able to give better advice to our teachers, because only teaching of high quality, which is expensive, perhaps one-to-one, with backup staff as well, will produce results. And we're not even certain that for many autistic children the results will be as good as some parents hope. There's better cause for optimism now than there was, I think, but I think we're still going to be up against the problem of having spent quite a lot of money on children and not produced an answer which parents are too happy about.
But at the end of the statutory school period, at the age of 16, what happens then?
There's no doubt that the future isn't too optimistic for many of them. There is a degree of mental subnormality attached to this condition, it would appear, and for many the chances of work, as you and I might say it is not there. There will be some who will be working in sheltered workshops, but this is again an area where we've got to make some advances and use our ingenuity and skill based upon the advice that we can be given on what to expect from these children.
And what will happen to the rest, the majority, who don't fit into either?
This is extremely difficult. I think some will be still in institutions when they're older, particularly when their parents grow older and are not able to look after them as well as they do in their dedicated way now.
The lifelong future for all autistic adolescents, except for the mildest cases, is an open question and a disturbing one. Even the few who as children have had the advantage of going to a special school will probably need, well beyond school age, individual care and attention. The first generation of diagnosed autistic children are now reaching adulthood. What are their prospects?
I hope, of course, desperately, that we are going to be able to provide the sort of setting that we believe is necessary. If the money is not forthcoming for that, inevitably it is going to mean that these children go home, to very caring homes, where parents are getting older, where siblings are going to be desperately worried about their share of the responsibility, and in time one imagines that the family situation will break down, the autistic adult will have to go away, it will be most likely to a subnormality hospital. We've spent years telling these kids, you're a person, you matter. We've encouraged them to feel, we've encouraged them to have insight, we've encouraged them to think and to live. And really, if they are going to have to be shut up in what is for them a living death, then we've committed a pretty terrible crime. We shouldn't have started in the first place if that's all we're going to offer them.
You really mean that? That if in fact you cannot continue the process indefinitely, that you should never have started it?
Yes, I do. I think a lot of children come to us not knowing who they are and not having very much in the way of feeling. In a funny sort of way, we've created them. We've done a Pygmalion act on rather a lot of our children to turn them back into stone. At this point is really unthinkable.
We're talking about a lifelong commitment.
Yes.
The commitment of Wendy Landman's school and the care and affection of her parents have given Kathy a personality and an awareness of herself, but her hold on them is still very tenuous.
She just goes to pieces and almost stops functioning when you withdraw the one adult who really understands her. And if we have to put that child in an environment where one person is not going to care that much about her, she will become doubly incontinent again, she will lose her speech, she will stop caring for herself, and she will probably have to be forcibly fed. If one puts her in a situation where there are different people coming on duty every day, every few hours, Kathy will no longer know who she is, she will no longer feel that anybody cares, and her hold on her own personality is so tenuous that she will let go. She will really, I think, stop living.
Kathy's future, once she has left the school, is always on her mother's mind.
One keeps hoping and one tries to think about it, but it's something in the... She's a young woman.
Mm.
And... I suppose one should be grateful if she can stay residential here till she's 18, is it?
Yes.
But then after that, our problems are just starting.
Yes, yes.
And some years ago, you may remember my telling you, I was a bit upset about something or other, and I remember talking to you about this, and saying that a parent said to me one day, I think we are going through the best years with our autistic children now.
Yes, I do remember that. I was just about to say it to you.
Yes, and I felt so panic-stricken at the thought that I might have to go through the screams and tantrums and a very worrying time again. I mean, I've 7 years to plan all of Kathy's life, and I don't even know where to start.
But there is some hope for the future. For 20 autistic children, ranging in age from 11 to 19, this bus journey through the Somerset countryside is the start of a crucial and lifelong experiment in community living. The experiment began this autumn and is the first of its kind in the country. Its purpose is to provide autistic children, for whom the official school leaving age has little or no meaning in terms of their actual ability, with a background in which they can continue to learn at their own pace for as long as they need to, in many cases for the rest of their lives. Somerset Court, the first fully residential centre for autistic adolescents, is the result of a 2-year search and much determined fundraising by its principal, Sybil Elgar, and the National Society for Autistic Children. The house is set in 20 acres of countryside, just 2 miles from the sea. How much did it cost?
The building plus the alterations, I think, are at about 125,000.
And where has that money come from?
Well, we haven't got parents sort of raise second mortgages, they draw out life insurance policies, they borrowed money, they raise money for small functions. We have a 50,000 bank loan at the moment, which is a sort of crippling handicap. If we are to develop and make the project viable, we need to get larger. I think we need to take in a maximum of 40, but we cannot go on to stage two to build until we can get out of debt.
How did you come to feel that a place like this was necessary?
Well, over the years, more and more of the children were expected to leave when they reached 16, 17 or 18. And they were in no way ready for it. They were no way ready socially. They were not able to, majority of them, in any way to fit into existing facilities such as sheltered workshops. They're just not motivated to be able to do this. And with the maturation lag, I felt and still feel that with a longer period of education on all levels, and I use the word education in its widest sense, social education, occupational education, academic education, then I think that there's a chance that quite a number of them will develop sufficiently to be self-organized and self-supporting. I'm not saying that they'll all be able to go out into the community, but at least they will be contributing within their community.
The 20 children at Somerset Court are doubly fortunate. They've already had the benefit of attending a special school in London. Now, in their new surroundings, they can continue that special education indefinitely. Some may be able, one day, to go out to sheltered workshops for the handicapped. But for the others, can they really be looked after here for the rest of their lives?
I think so. I think there are some that will go out, but even those that remain within this community, I think will be better able to live with dignity. They'll be able to contribute more. They will know the place, they'll know the things they can do, feed the chickens, feed the ducks, help in the garden, help with the various things that go on in the house. This, I think, is a far more promising and hopeful thing for them than just sort of saying, well, we can't do any more. I think you have to keep on trying.
That's it. That's better.
The first few days showed some of the promise of Somerset Court and also the problems.
One more.
Only with constant and patient supervision can these adolescents be encouraged to cooperate.
You press it down with your finger. Go on, put it in there. Don't be silly now. Come on, put it in there. Brilliant, now come on. That's it.
In addition to the handicap of autism, they share in the general problems of growing up.
Well, I think they have all the physiological and psychological changes that other adolescents get, but they have very little way of overcoming it. I mean, normal adolescents are join groups to save the world or to destroy the world, and they have other ways of working out excess energy, but these children haven't got that. They haven't any way of doing this. And so they do quite often become a little bit difficult in these sort of adolescent years. They become less easy to handle, and they become less willing to conform.
Do they have special problems with sexual development?
Well, it's like every other aspect of their development. It's immature. You know, you get the kind of situation where an 18-year-old boy, because you say in the garden, well, we're all going swimming, and he solemnly goes up and starts to undress a 16-year-old girl. And, of course, you stop this and say, oh, come along and take him in. And this happens again, and then you think, well, this is not going to be socially acceptable, so I'd better say something about this. So you say to the young man, you don't see Mr. X undress Miss B when we're going swimming. You don't see Miss Y undress Mr. X when we're going swimming, do you? And he says no, and you say, well, you know, boys do not undress girls. Do you understand?
Yes, and off he goes quite happily, and you find him immediately undressing a boy in the playground because you didn't say, boys don't undress boys. And this is the kind of thing that happened. They will rush up to someone in a shop or something and throw their arms around them, an 18-year-old boy, and you know, nuzzle their faces or sort of clutch them, which can be easily misunderstood. But it isn't a sort of sexual drive. It's just the sort of thing that a youngster will do, of 4 or 5. They do this kind of thing.
Somerset Court is the first systematic attempt to cope with the continuing problems of autistic children as they grow to physical maturity. But there are thousands of adults already who've never had such a chance, and thousands more children at present growing up who probably never will. Doesn't the sheer scale of the problem depress Mrs. Elgar?
It depresses me, of course it depresses me, but what I'm hoping is, you see, when I first started to teach these children in 1962, at that stage it was not generally accepted that education, in the way I meant education, was of any value to autistic children at all. Now, during the years, the Society for Autistic Children, it was then, it's now the National Society for Autistic Children, have provided schools with our methods of teaching, and it's been proved that education is in fact of great value to the young child. We're hoping that if this project is as successful as the schools have been, the sort of early part of education, the further education is as successful as schools have been, then local authorities and other responsible government bodies will take it as a pattern and develop on these kind of lines. Now, I know that a number of officials at various education authorities that I have been dealing with over the years have phoned me and said, Mrs. Elgar, we should be watching with great interest what you do there. It could well be a pattern. It is a pioneer project. I know it is. But I think it's going to work. And if it does work, we're hoping it will become a pattern for future communities.
Would it be fair to say that, in a way, it's been a waste of time to give them special training or special teaching as children if you're going to stop it?
I think it's absolutely true. It's not fair. I think it's absolutely true to say that. If you're going to spend all the money on providing a special kind of education, why should it stop at 16? It isn't their fault they grow up. We all grow older. And I think it's necessary for these children to continue. Otherwise, why bother to start?
In the 10 years since David was diagnosed as autistic, little progress has been made in determining the cause or perhaps causes of the condition. In this country, every year, the parents of a further 300 autistic children must begin the long struggle of attempting to get the right kind of help and attempting to do what's best for their child. But when the official school years are over, the problem is even more acute. Autistic adults often remain mental children for the rest of their lives. Whether or not they have had special help up to 16, there is now only one place in the whole of the country, catering for 20 people, where that special help can be continued. The alternatives are home or hospital. Autistic children give little in material terms to our society. It is for society to decide whether it can afford to give them what they need for the whole of their lives.
I don't think we can afford not to. I think the alternative, well, there are two alternatives to saying we can't afford to look after children like this. One is to give them what amounts to a life sentence, a sort of living death. And the other is to say, right, as a society, we will go in for large-scale euthanasia. I don't believe, as people, that we can afford to answer either of those two alternatives in that way. I don't believe we can afford to do that to ourselves.